Thank you, Jesus. Father, we glorify you, we praise you, we bless you, we magnify you, and we thank you for loving us and having us in this place. I love what the men of God said on Tuesday when I brought them to my platform. They were preaching and one of them said something that Prophet Sally reminded me of. He said, even with this quarantine and in the church, there are two kinds of people. You have the goat people and you have the sheep people. The goats, even in the time of quarantine, there will still be goats. They will still not find God. They will still not hear God. They will still not follow God. They will still not do what God wants them to do. The goats will still be crying the same way they were crying before quarantine came. They will still be complaining the same way, criticizing everybody why they themselves are doing nothing. Always stupidly judging people. Meanwhile, themselves don't know what they are doing. Those are the goats. Always going the wrong side. God is saying, go right. The goats will always go where God is not leading them. Goats are people who do not follow instruction. They are not submitted to leaders. They do whatever they want to do. And they do it whenever they want to do. Are you all with me?
Amen.
They do what they want to do. And they do what they want to do, when they want to do, how they want to do. There is no accountability in the goats. They will still remain the same. Quarantine will come and go. The same warfare they came in with during quarantine is what they will come out with during quarantine. Those are the goats. Something in them is not yielded to God. And that's the place Satan is still passing through to torment the goats. Are you with me?
Amen.
Our pride level is still very high. You will know the goats by how they still talk even in this time.
Come on.
What they still do. How they still treat the things of God. How they still treat the word of God. And the information that we are giving to them. But you will know the sheep by how they are yielded. You know, goats are easy to listen to the voice of outsiders. Because the ears and the attentions of the goats is not in the house of God. It's not in tune to God. They love to hear things that will suit their flesh. They enjoy the things Paul calls it. Their itchy ears like to hear things will suit their flesh. And the thing is God. But they are going astray. The goats settle for instant gratification. Something that pleases them now. But I want to remind all of us that there is always a tomorrow.
Amen. Amen.
There is always a tomorrow. Goats are the one who complain that the word of God is too much. The work in the house of God is too much. This is too much. That is too much. Because something in them is yet not yielded. Because when you yield to God, things become easy. Then there is no fight between you and God. You go with the waves. You go with the flow. And God carries you. If you are still struggling, because you feel like you are in church too much, you are in that too much, you are too involved in the things of God, that's where the problem is. Something in you has not said, God, yes, Lord. You say it with your lips, but in your heart and your spirit, you are not yielded to God. Goats always want to make their own decision. Goats will take, you know, if you still have a part of you as a goat, if you take decision on your own without your leader, if you are under leadership, those are goats. It means every part of you is not yielded yet. You still want to be your own person. You are not yielded. And that's where the fight is. I don't have problem being in the house of God 24/7 or doing the things of God. Because I finally said, yes, God, for real.
Amen, come on.
So whatever he asks me to do by the power of the Holy Spirit, I try to do it in such a way that I sometimes look stupid. People take me for granted. Because I will reach out to people who others may not want to reach out to. I will apologize when other people are wrong. When God says, go do it, I do it. Because I've said yes, Lord. Are you with me today?
Amen.
But I'm happy that next to the goats, God has his sheep. Are there any sheep in the house of God today? God has the people who are said, for God I live. For God I die. No matter what happens, I'm going with God. Anybody here ready to go with God?
Amen.
No matter what happens, I'm going with God.
Yes.
Sheep don't complain. They can explain that they are tired or going through things. But you will test from the spirit that they are sheep. Even when they say they don't want to do something or can't do something, they are just being honest, not because they are rebellious. There's a difference.
Yeah.
There's a difference. Because at the end of the day, we are all human, living in this human body, going through human experiences. When you rebuke a sheep, they may cry, but you will see them come back and still love and still submit. But gods are the ones that any little thing, they leave the church, they throw tantrum, they insult people, they condemn a church that has been blessing to them. Those are gods. And they will still come out of this quarantine the same way if God doesn't arrest them. So I want to encourage every one of us here and those online. Be determined about who you want to be.
Amen.
Be clear with God about who you want to be. Some people have used this quarantine as an excuse to fulfill their normal flesh desire. What am I saying? Some people never wanted to be coming to church. Some people don't like coming to prayer, but they want prayer. They want everything from God, but they don't want to give anything to God or to their church. So quarantine came as a blessing to them. Because now they have an excuse that, oh, because of coronavirus and quarantine, that's why I'm not in church. No, that's not why. That's your real nature. That's your true heart. Because even with the corona in some places, some nations and some areas, the government say a particular number of people are allowed to be in church. So why are you not the one of the 30?
Come on.
Hello? Or if they say only 10 people, why are you not one of the 10 who are in church? Why are you one of the majority who has not shown yourself to prayer, church, or anything since the quarantine, even though your church is open? Because if you really was a person who said, for God I live and God I die, and you follow authority of the government, and you follow the safety rule, you can say, I'm going to my church, and I will quarantine myself by sitting behind. But I will be in the house of God no matter what. But some of you have the opportunity, whether it is in America, Africa, or wherever, to just show your face and keep social distance and make sure you are still safe. But you still don't do it because that's your true you. You are happy that there is quarantine. You will be surprised. But there are truly people who are happy that there is quarantine.
Yep.
because of corona, they can have an excuse why they are not giving tithes and offering, why they are not helping their church. Those are goats. They are not, they come to church to get something from God once in a while. But they are not truly yielded to God. But God is calling the yielded ones. God is calling the submitted ones. God is calling the ones who are wise. And say, I'm not going to put myself in danger. Because you know there are people who are still home and not connected. They're not connected even through social media. You will make a video like this, they are sitting home. They will rather watch other ministers and forget to watch the home that is the house that God has said, this is your source. They are home. You will be surprised. Many people on Zion are home right now. But if God will show you what they are doing, they know we are online. But they're careless. They're careless. And there are many people around the world like that. Your pastors, your leaders are doing everything to help you, but you are not helping anybody. There are people who are not taking the time. Not even one day since quarantine. I'm talking around the world. To send their pastor a message. Pastor, how are you? No heart for their leader. They only know how to complain, criticize, but no love for the one who shepherd you. And we want God to help us. For all of us online and those around the world who are watching this, when was the last time you asked your man of God or your woman of God, how are you? Or send them a sweet message. Woman of God, I'm praying for you. Man of God, I'm praying for you. How are you? And those are the ones who are quick to complain that the church is doing nothing for them. But what have you done for your church lately? What have you done for your leader lately? That's why many leaders die in silence. Some of them are committing suicide, all kinds of things, because there are no people who are really holding them up in the spirit. And we call ourselves children of God. You are a sheep. Don't forget that even though your leader is your leader is still a sheep of God. Many people in churches will give accountability to God for how they treat their leaders, for how the devil passed through all of them. Talking. Vision seeing, dream seeing. You didn't see that your leader was about to commit suicide. You didn't see that they were depressed. By the way, don't be worried. I'm not depressed or about to commit suicide. I'm speaking the word of God.
Amen. Come on.
To the church. Is somebody with me?
Amen.
Sometimes 1,000 members, and not one person saw that the man was about to take his life. Because church people have become very wicked, very greedy, very selfish. It's all about me. Complaining. No grace and mercy. You expect pastors and leaders to be perfect when you yourself are still the messier messes. You are messier than all the mess. You have no grace or mercy for your leader. One mistake, they are condemned. We need to be careful, people of God.
Amen.
I used to surprise, like, a man of God will preach and then kill himself. I'm wondering. And then the church will say, none of us saw it coming. None of you saw it coming. And I've gone also and watched men of God who took their life. Their messages that they preached before they took their life. Like 1 or 2 weeks before. And I could see in the message that many times a person said it, that they were going through depression. Your pastor is preaching and crying. You think it's the Holy Spirit. You cannot discern. They are preaching constantly about pain, rejection, emotional problem, psychological problem, people being rejected, people being thrown away. Every time they are preaching, you see them weeping. Can't you discern that they are telling you it is not well with them? They are telling you. They are putting themselves out there. And oftentimes, pastors don't know who to trust. Because people think you need to be Jesus. You don't have feeling. You don't have pain. People talk to you anyhow. They reject you. They use you. They throw you away. Talk about your name like nothing. But they want you to be okay. And not all pastors can handle that. That's why some of them kill themselves. With the stress and the pressure of betrayal, rejection. People always talking bad about you. And they forget the good to do. Let us be people who care for one another.
Amen.
Not only your pastor should care for you. When was the last time you cared for your pastor? Not only your pastor should defend you. When was the last time you defend your woman or man of God? People are talking about the one who is killing themselves for you. You two are there on the phone. Yeah, I know. Yeah, I don't know why. You are on the phone. Killing the one who is maybe in the house. Praying for you. You are a goat. That's why I tell my armor bearers, don't ever let anything break you and I. If I see you joining yourself to a person who is hurting me, that day is over. Because every pastor must have somebody who can defend them and stand for them and say, no. This is not my woman of God. Even if they are not perfect, but you can't talk about her like that. You can't talk about him like that. No, I'm sorry, not in my presence, not in my watch. You need somebody. Don't forget the time your pastors pour oil on you and cast demons. Don't forget. That's not wisdom. Foolish people are the one who tarnish the man or woman of God who has labored for them. They've labored for you, suffer for you. And you put them in the air and hang them to dry. You are a goat. May God give us the heart and the spirit of sheep. Wisdom is not always to scrutinize and examine every little thing your leader does and say, that was wrong, I shouldn't hear. No, that's not wisdom. I love what one man of God says. He said, do not ever take critic from anybody who has not done half of what you are doing. If you are not doing better than me, shut your mouth. Because you don't know what it takes for people to go and be where God has called them to be. If it was easy, everybody would have been there. Do you know how many people get frozen just to preach a 5-minute message? 5 minutes. Let us call some of you to be preaching every week like we do. You will not have life. You will have heart attack and maybe die. People don't know what it costs to search the word. Carry the weight of a church. The responsibility to feed the sheep. And you come here every day as if you live together with Jesus, the word just flow. You don't know what it costs. How many of you have ever shared a message or tried to come share a 5-minute message and the devil resists you? Bring torment in your mind. Bring confusion in your spirit. Intimidates you with fear. You are paralyzed. But your man or woman of God can stand every week, day after day, and preach for hours. measure your strength and their strength. That should already tell you that for them to stand for more than 1 hour or 2 hours and pray, preach, sing, do everything, cast out demon, prophesy, and weekly do it without you seeing the fall down, that should tell you that they are above you. Is somebody with me? That's a measuring stick. If you are scared for 5 minute message, where will I get it? You are praying, you are shaking, and then somebody takes a microphone every time he gives a rhema word. Doesn't that tell you something about ranking? All of us are children of God. Yes, we are. But all of us don't have the same position. I should tell you something. And you have the audacity to talk about them anyhow. When they preach a message, you say, wow, that is a sign that they are your senior. To give you that wow effect. Are you with me? So in this season, why am I saying this? I want to encourage every sheep to separate yourself from the goats.
Amen.
Because if you don't, the goats will lead you astray. Are you with me?
Amen.
Separate your ears. And it has nothing to do with age. There are some elderly people, older people who are just goats. Don't give your ears to such people. Are you with me?
Amen.
Don't give your ears to friends whom every time you talk to is negativity about your church, negativity about Christians, negativity about your sisters, negativity about your brothers. They have to complain about the word. They have to complain about the preaching. And they have to complain about your voice. They have to complain about how you shout. They have to complain about everything. That's a demonic spirit. Some people tell my members that your apostle, who does she think she is? Tell them she's my apostle. She thinks she's a woman of God. She knows she's a woman of God. That's why she speaks the way she speaks. Are you with me? Be very careful who puts anything in your spirit in this season. Be careful. Because I must tell you people, there is a separation going on in the spirit. Separation between the good and the bad. Separation between the real and the fake. Are you with me?
Amen.
Separation between the goats and the sheep. May you be found in the line of the sheep.
Amen.
Are you with me? Don't be counted among the goats, but be counted amongst the sheep. Be one of those who have made up their mind that this is my life. There is no other life. If you are part of a ministry or a church or a network that God puts you there, be sure that God puts you there. Don't be, is it? Is it not? This is not the time to be wondering, is it? Is it not? It's a time to know.
Come on. That's true. Yes.
And if you don't know, seek God to know.
Come on. Yes.
Because the Bible said, they that are planted in the house of God shall flourish. Make sure you are planted as a sheep, because you can come and be planted as a goat. But as for Zion, every goat shall be uprooted.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Because we don't have time to be wasting time.
Amen.
We are here for people who are serious. People who want to move further with God.
Yes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
People who plan to serve God. Because if you leave the goat among the sheep, sooner or later the sheep will begin to act like goats. Because bad company corrupts good character. Are you with me?
Amen.
That's why we must continue to pray that God should purify us.
Amen.
God should purify our mind. God should purify our spirit, our integrity.
Amen.
And ask God to cause you to block in. May you be plucked in God Himself.
Amen.
Yes.
And God doesn't have tribes and villages. God has one nation, it's a kingdom. He has one body, it's a body of Christ.
Yes.
Are you with me?
Amen.
And in the body of Christ, everybody comes from one nation. It's called the kingdom of God.
Yes.
They are not Surinams or Surinamese or what you call them. They are not Jamaicans in the kingdom. They are all citizens of God. There are no, you are from Africa, you are white or black. In God, all He has is sons and daughters.
Amen. Yes.
So let's stop that nonsense. People say, you are white, why are you in a black church? You are black, why are you in a white church? You are from Kirusa, why are you in a person who is from Cameroon church? You are from Suriname, why are you in a Nigerian church? That is ignorance. Lack of understanding of kingdom concepts. God does not look by your natural birth. He looks by your spiritual birth. And He plants you in a house as a citizen of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
He doesn't plant you as a person from Kirusa. Hey, you are planted here. You are from Holland. No, you are a citizen of the house of God.
Amen.
One family. And God doesn't look at gender.
Amen.
Come on.
God doesn't look, is a shepherd going to be a woman or a man? No, God is looking at the person with the spirit of God to shepherd like God.
Come on.
Yes, that's it.
God is a spirit. And because He is a spirit, He can be in any vessel. That's why God is in a woman and God is in a man. The same spirit. And when God positions any person, He doesn't lead them by their physical body. He leads them by Him in their spirit.
Come on.
He doesn't make women to preach women Bible. Have you ever seen women Bible? Have you ever seen men Bible? Whether your pastor is a man or a woman, it's the same Bible. Are you with me?
Amen.
It's one Bible. God doesn't separate it. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. That scripture does not change because it's a woman saying it. Does it change?
No.
It remains the same. So now that we are talking about wisdom, your mentality has to have an upgrade. Now when people come to you, when gods come to you with stupid arguments, may your wisdom cap be elevated.
Amen.
Yes.
And you begin to think out of the spirit of God.
Come on.
And the wisdom of God. That's why the Bible says, the wisdom that comes from above is first of all pure.
Come on.
If they want to mention anything from to you about whatever, you have to discern. Do I sense purity in it? If their wisdom given to you is good, you will ask, do I discern purity? Mm-hmm. Or do I discern jealousy, bitterness, wickedness, or foolishness? Because the wisdom is first of all. If somebody is advising you, they may tell you it's wisdom, but you must calculate, is this thing, do I sense God or do I sense the enemy?
Amen. Yes.
It may sound good, but if it's not pure, it's not from God. Are you with me?
Amen.
It's not of God. If it doesn't bring They call you on the phone talking to you about things. And all of a sudden, something that you were sure about, you are no longer sure. Your spirit is stirred up. You go home irritated. You are irritated at your leaders that you normally have fellowship with. You know you love the person, they love you. You are cool with your pastor or with your leader. All of a sudden, you have a conversation with somebody about your church. You go home, you are messed up. You begin to doubt your leader. That is telling you that the vessel that came with you with that word, it sounded good, but that wisdom was not from heaven.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Amen.
That wisdom wasn't from heaven. So we must discern in the spirit. Our wisdom, you know, God gave us a mind.
Come on.
He gave us a head. And in that head, there is something that behind this thing called his insight. It's called a brain. And that brain, the function is to use to think. To reason. They call it reasoning faculties. Not everything people say to you, you just take. You have to think. And they say, wait a minute. Let me think at it from the light of God. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Use your reasoning faculties to think.
Amen.
If not, praying wisdom and anointing yourself with wisdom, oh, wisdom rests upon my heart, has no use if you can't think.
True. Amen. Yes.
You must think.
Amen.
You must analyze.
Amen.
And let it sink in your belly, in your spirit man. And say, this thing that I've just heard, or this thing that I'm thinking, is it truth? Is it of God? Is it helping me? Are you with me?
Yeah.
If every time you have that conversation with that person, and your spirit is messed up, why are you still having that conversation?
Yeah.
You can test by how you feel after. That this is not a conversation you should be having with this person anymore.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Amen.
Be wise and do not allow venom in your spirit.
Amen.
We are asking God to purify us, sanctify us. And after you prayed and shouted, oh, mercy, 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 the first phone call is somebody who is putting back venom in your spirit. You have to reject it. How can we finish praying and we should no longer gossip? And after prayer meeting, you call somebody and you are gossiping. Or you allow somebody to call you and you discern that what they are saying is gossip. Now, gossip is different from calling somebody from a genuine heart to explain a situation. Every time you talk to somebody about somebody, it's not gossip. Are you with me?
Yeah.
That's not gossip. Because you must discern the spirit behind it. And why are you saying that thing? Are you saying it to really genuinely get understanding? Or do you just come to tell somebody's business? And to break them down. For example, let me say I say something to Joey, and Joey doesn't understand why I said that or what I said, and he's struggling, but he doesn't want to come to me directly to ask me, Apostle, what do you mean? And he feels like he wants to talk to somebody, and he goes to Peter. But he goes to Peter not to gossip, but just to be like, brother, I'm struggling with this thing. What Apostle said, this is how I feel about it. It's troubling me. What do you think? That's not gossip.
Yeah.
If he went with a genuine spirit, just to explain what he's struggling with and want understanding, that's not gossip. That's looking for understanding from the right spirit. But if he goes to Peter and say, yeah, I'm getting so fed up with Apostle, and every time this, I really don't understand this church. I feel like leaving this church. Peter, what do you think? Because yeah, I see sometimes the way he talks to you, and yeah, we cannot take this. We are men. Then that's a wrong spirit. So now Peter needs to be able to discern that Joey came to him with the wrong spirit. But if Peter is not discerning, and he is also with the same spirit, the two of them will go in that thing, and then before you know, we are dealing with an enemy in the house. They form an ungodly alignment. So now if Joey goes to Peter like, just really want to understand something and just find wisdom, Peter now has to be righteous enough to just listen peacefully and Joey, and then give him righteous counsel. Godly counsel. Yeah, brother, I understand. I understand you are facing difficulties, but you know, remember this, remember this. Maybe you should talk to apostle, or maybe she said it this way, or maybe you should check yourself. You know, bring wisdom. And they say, maybe because you are in your process, you are struggling with that, and blah, blah, blah. But the point is, you give a wise counsel, a godly. The Bible says the wisdom from above is first of all what?
Pure.
You don't pour the fire, you don't pour more petrol on the fire. He comes with fire. And you just say, yeah, I know. Silver, I thought I was the only one. Blah, 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 blah. And then you didn't help him. And you didn't help yourself. Are you with me? The same with relationship, men and women. Your husband comes home and says something to you. Don't tell your husband to just put more fire and then the two of you are in trouble. One person should be wise. One person should be calm. One person should be the reasoning faculty. Both of us can be emotional. Are you with me?
Amen.
There was a time we went to a bank and we're trying to open a bank account. And this bank was giving us so much trouble, difficulties. We went, we came back, we gave all the documents and everything. But they were still not helping us. And one of the days we went there, we met the director of the bank in a private office because we want to open a company bank account, an organization for the church. And I was so irritated. I was not having it. I actually went there to punch somebody in the face if I would have my way. Because we're just like irritating me, discriminating us, accusing us that they saw that we are embezzling money. I'm like, we don't even have, at that time the church was just starting. We didn't even have offering. And they said, blah, 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 is connected to mafia. I was like, Jesus. All kind of things they told us. They saw we have 148 branches in Africa. I said, in the spirit, we received that prophecy. But right now, it's not true. That's wisdom. As a prophesy for the future, but right now, it's not true. Because they wanted to ask us, how come we have 148 branches all over the world? I was like, we are just three of us. There's no branch. We don't even have a member. And we have been explaining ourselves back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And that last day, I was like, I'm not having it. So we went there myself, Prophetess Sally and Evangelist Sandra, we went in. They already saw my face from the car. They know this woman, she's out to kill. So when we went to the bank manager's office, we were sitting there, was the bank director, whatever. They brought all kind of documents and accusation. Before the man could speak, do you see how I have authority in preaching? That's not the same anointing I carried in the bank. Before I could open my mouth up, Prophetess Sally already saw it in the spirit. Evangelist also saw in the spirit that this man's about to say something that is going to make us not to even have this bank account at all. They just held me on my shoulder. I wanted to say, look, Prophetess Sally just pressed me on one shoulder. Evangelist was pressing my foot. I was like, what are they pressing me for? But they were giving me divine sign, like apostle, this is not a time for you to speak. We got this. And trust me, until that meeting with the bank director was finished, I didn't say a word.
Amen.
These women helped. One was holding me on one side, the other one was pressing my lap and touching me, like, you know, like, let me be keeping her calm. While prophetess was speaking, evangelist was just holding. Do you remember you were just holding me? Like, we need to quarantine apostle. You know?
Yeah.
They quarantined me in the back. So, prophetess calmed herself down. She spoke with such wisdom. And when I heard that, I was like, wow, that's wisdom. But I was still bawling. Like, let me say something. And the evangelist was like, don't say a word. And then they did all the talking. The only thing I did was to sign. They did not allow me to talk or to do anything. Why am I saying this? It's good to be in alliance with people who you can exchange roles.
Yeah.
When you are too up, they bring the balance by being down. When you are too down, they bring the balance by pulling you up. If all of us now went there with the drama of Apostle Claire revealed, the security would have thrown three of us out and there would have been no bank account.
Amen.
One of the days, Pastor Carmen came here and they were doing the women program. Was it the day of the crowning? Yes, the day of the crowning. So normally I don't come to the women for women after God has programmed because I want them to be free. So that day I say, they are giving crowns for quit. I'm not going to miss no crown. I'm coming to Zion also. So I brought my beautiful self. When I came, I was still at the bank. Pastor Karma was still next to me and some other people. I noticed that the women did not have drinks on the table. No water, no cups. So I was making sign to Regina and Meline to put some water on the table and some drinks. But they were not getting my sign because I didn't want to interrupt the service. So I was like, nobody was getting it. And my hot water in my belly began to boil. I was like, God. I was like, can somebody put tea and whatever and cookies on the tables? While we are talking, the women can be eating. They were still not getting the point. And I shout, Jesus! Before I could shout Jesus, Pastor Kama just pressed me on my waist. I don't know if she could remember. And then the whole time we were in the service that I was still next to Pastor Kama, she was tapping my lap. Because she could feel my energy that, and she was just like, just tapping me like, calm down. You know? Because we all are not the same. She understood that the people needed a drink, is right. But she knows her apostle. She knows I was about to just shut everything down. Because I'm like, we are not going to preach one more second until there's water and whatever we need on the table. And she calmed me down while they finally got the instruction and they served the water and all of them went. Do you get my point? We all cannot be the same. We have to work with people who are able to bring, who understand you, love you enough not to abandon you, but are able to bring the right balance in your life. Woo! I just said something.
Amen.
I just said something.
Amen.
You have to be with people that when you are too up, they know how to bring you on a normal level. The same with married people. Your wife cannot be causing drama and the husband is causing drama. The husband cannot be beating everybody and the wife is beating everybody. One person has to say, no, there's been too much beating around this house. Let's calm down and just talk. One person needs to be the voice of reasoning. Is this helping anybody?
Yeah.
Don't be like my husband. One is like this, so I'm the wife. Two has become one. All of us going to be crazy over here. No. Why can two not become one in the good things?
Amen.
Why must two become one in the bad things?
Amen.
Is somebody with me? So we must use wisdom in this time to examine the people around us and decide what we want to be, how we want to be, what kind of people we want to be, and what kind of influences we want to have around us. That's wisdom. If you are always with somebody, you need to learn to shift yourself. Don't copy the wrong things, but learn to copy the what? The right things. Be a person who copies the right things. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Is somebody with me today?
Amen.
The people online, is anybody being blessed?
Amen.
Anybody being blessed?
Amen.
Go with me to Proverbs chapter 4. Are the people online being blessed? Hallelujah. If you are being blessed online, everybody hashtag blessed. Are you being blessed online? Online family. Those online, if you are being blessed, hashtag blessed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. I want us to go to Proverbs chapter 4. Verse 5 till 12. Proverbs chapter 4. Everybody online, if you are blessed, hashtag blessed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 5 to 12. It says, get wisdom, develop good judgment. Don't forget my words or turn away from them. Don't turn your back on wisdom, for she will protect you. Somebody say, wisdom has protection. It says, don't turn your back from wisdom. Don't turn your back on wisdom, for she will protect you. Love her, and she will guard you. Getting wisdom is the wisest thing you can do. And whatever else you do, develop good judgment. If you prize wisdom, it means if you put wisdom first, and honor wisdom, she will make you great. Embrace her. Embrace wisdom. And she will honor you. She will place a lovely wreath on your head. She will present you with a beautiful crown. When you walk, you won't be held back. When you run, you won't stumble. This is of those. Is anybody online putting the scriptures down? This is for those who embrace wisdom. God is saying to us that we must. He said, get wisdom. That's why we are praying and getting wisdom. We want to be wise people because there are benefits in wisdom. There are treasures that wisdom gives. There are things that wisdom gives. He said, get wisdom. Getting wisdom is the wisest thing you can do. Now watch this, verse 6 says, when you get wisdom and don't turn your back on wisdom, wisdom will protect you. How many people want to be protected?
Amen.
Amen. And wisdom does not just protect you because you say, I love wisdom. It means when you get wisdom, the wisdom in you will prevent you from doing foolish things.
Yep.
Amen? Amen? Wisdom will make you to escape danger. Some people will see danger and they still run into it because they lack wisdom. There was a guy who died in Cameroon. You know why he died? He had a bottle of Fanta. They went to a beach with a friend. He bought a bottle of Fanta. When he opened the Fanta, the foam of the Fanta was running over the bottle, which means he was losing some of his Fanta. But because of greed and he didn't want to lose his Fanta, he quickly put the bottle with foam in his mouth to get his drink and not let it waste. But because of the foam, it went into his nostrils and everything. He choked and he died at the spot. He died. Lack of wisdom. If he had wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, he would have just waited. He would have saved his life by taking the good decision. Because wisdom helps you to make a good decision. He would have been protected by wisdom based on the decision he made. But because he did not do that, he lost his life. Get wisdom, and wisdom will protect you. Amen? The Bible said, love her and she will guard you. That guy would have been guarded, which is also part of protection, if he had wisdom. Amen?
Amen.
Like some men of God now, may all of their soul rest in peace. Laying hands on coronavirus patients when God has not sent you, it's not wisdom. There is a difference between faith and foolishness. There's a thin line. With God, you must always follow his wisdom and his guidelines. Amen?
Amen.
If you want to go and lay your hands, use wisdom to have maximum protection. Because there is a physical realm and there is a spiritual realm. Use spiritual wisdom to protect you from the physical things. Amen?
Amen.
So, he said, wisdom will guard you. He said, get wisdom and develop good judgment. When you get wisdom, it helps you to develop good judgment. You can make good judgment. Judge things rightly. Amen?
Amen.
Should I go or should I stay? You think well and make the right decision. Amen? He says, don't turn your back on wisdom. Okay, verse 7 says, get wisdom is the wisest thing you can do. And whatever else you do, develop good judgment. Verse 8, it says, if you prize wisdom, if you honor wisdom, if you put wisdom first, if you esteem wisdom, if you fall in love with wisdom, she will make you great. How many people want to be great?
Amen.
How many people want greatness?
Amen.
People are saying, God, make me great. But God is telling you the secret of getting great.
Amen.
He said, get wisdom and become great. Amen.
Amen?
Amen. He said, when you make wisdom great in your life, wisdom now will give you what to give back to wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
You will reap what to sow. So become a lover of wisdom.
Amen.
And wisdom will become a lover of you.
Amen.
And how many of you know if you love somebody, you want to take care of them?
That's true.
You want to protect them.
Amen.
He said, make wisdom your friend. If you prize wisdom, she will make you great. Embrace her and she will honor you. How many people want honor?
Amen.
Yeah, honor wisdom. Just this thing that we are doing in Zion. Giving room for wisdom to prevail.
Amen.
God will honor this church.
Amen.
Wisdom will cause this church to be great.
Amen.
Because it's a church that realizes that we need wisdom.
Amen.
It means we need God. And we understand by the word of God that wisdom is a builder.
Amen.
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 If you want to build, use wisdom.
Come on.
He says she will place a lovely wreath of gold of crown upon your head. People of God, don't be weary of us praying about wisdom. Don't be weary of us speaking about wisdom. Don't be weary of us prophesying about wisdom. Is somebody with me?
Amen.
Don't be weary, but be steadfast.
Amen.
It's our season for wisdom.
Amen.
And in our wisdom, we must separate ourselves from people who want to remain in foolishness.
Amen.
People who reject wisdom. You give them counsel. There are some people I don't even want to counsel anymore. Because you counsel them, they throw your counsel, and they turn it into something else. Don't take wise advice. Amen?
Amen.
May we be people who receive wise counsel. In the name of Jesus. Let us take our offering. Hallelujah. Let's take our offering. I think that the network is being problem. They said that the thing loops this fast. Let's take our offering. Those online, but maybe it was before. I haven't seen anything else. But Kelly is sending me a message.
Watching the first one.
I don't know. Everybody online, let's have the information online so the online people can give. Hallelujah. Anybody blessed today? Anybody blessed by the word of God? Be encouraged and don't be discouraged. Honestly, separate yourself from the goats. It will profit you. Disconnect from the goats and connect the sheep. Hallelujah. You want to give God a good offering. Every fire starter, give to God. Every person from Zion family, give to God. Our online viewers, our visitors, we ask you and encourage you to sow your seed. This is a fruitful ground. We are asking you to send your seed in the house of God. You can send your seed through bank account. You can send your seed to PayPal, to Cash App. But make sure you are partaker of what God is doing. God is doing a great thing. Hallelujah. If you are in Zion, send your seed. Even though you are home, you still need to give to your God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Brother Dudley, God is going to do great things for you.
Amen.
We were talking about you the other day with Prophetess Anne. Evangelist, and they said to me, Apostle, he's a true son. Some people come in, they don't know whether they want to jump or stand or whether they are here or out, but we sense in the spirit that you came in with 2 feet.
Amen.
You came in ready to plug first in God.
Yeah.
To put your 2 feet
in God.
Totally in God. And to put your 2 feet totally in this house. So may God bless you. May God keep you. May God strengthen you. You are a humble man at heart. And that's why God is going to use you. I really see a bright future in you. Shami really found a man of God. Yeah, she did. She found a man of God because your heart is for God.
Amen.
You don't know everything yet, You are still a baby in Christ. You are growing. But I see your hunger. And God will fulfill that hunger.
Amen.
God will make you full. Continue to plug in. Press. I really encourage you to go closer to the men of this house. Stay close to Joey and Peter. Stay connected. Stay connected to the men's ministry. Because God is going to train you and use you.
Amen.
Yeah. You are not just a man in this house. You are a son.
Amen.
It's not everybody I can call a son. Because not everybody in your church is your son or daughters. In the church, there are three kind of people. You have visitors who can leave at any time. You have church members who just come to the church, but they are not plucked in the church. Those are church members. They are members of the church. And you have sons and daughters. Those are the ones who are deeper. They are connected to the mother or the father of the house. They are connected to the vision. They are connected to whatever is happening in the house. When you turn around, you will see sons and daughters. But when you turn around often, you will not see visitors and you will not see church members. And God told me you are a son.
Yeah.
And sons and daughters are those that should be trained. Because you can discipline them. You can appoint them. You can correct them. You can position them because they are close. When you tell them something, they will follow. But those who just come sometimes and then 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 1 month, you don't know where they are. Those are church members. You can't invest in them. But you are a son.
Amen.
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 So may God bless you and keep you. And I pray that you do not fail to keep on with this spirit.
Amen.
This is the right way. What you are doing now is the right thing to do. You are a true priest of your home because you make sure your wife and child, you guys are always in Bible study. You guys are always in the house of God. A true man of God leads his house to God.
Amen.
You are always here on Sunday. Since you came to this church, always on Sunday, always on Thursdays. You haven't missed one thing. That's a true man of God who wants his home to be guided by God.
Amen.
And may God bless you for that.
Amen.
Amen. Let's bring our offering. If you haven't brought your offering, bring it now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. And just the fact that, you know, the Bible says from their fruit you will know them. You haven't been here for long. Just the fact that you went on whatever day and Sunday you brought me a gift. That says a lot.
Amen. Come on. It's true.
You understand me?
Mm-hmm.
It says a lot. You bought something. Oh, I'll give apostle. We'll give this to apostle. It says a lot.
Amen.
I don't look at how big gifts are.
No.
I look at the heart. That somebody will think of you and buy something to you, carry it to church.
Come on.
And say, apostle, I brought something for you. That's what sons and daughters do. They take care of their mother and their father. Whether it is naturally or spiritually. You are a son.
Amen.
You are a son. Amen.
Amen.
So let evangelists come and continue in prayer. You ready? Somebody clap for Jesus. Those online, have you been blessed so far? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
We give you worship, Lord. We give you adoration, Lord. We give you praise. We thank you, Abba Father, for your wisdom releasing upon us, my God, day by day, night by night. Abba Father, thank you that we're not forgotten, my God. Thank you for empowering us with your wisdom, my God. We honor you, we praise you, we glorify you, my King. We magnify you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Proverbs 8, verse 30.
Amen. Jesus, we worship you.
Hallelujah. Proverbs 8, verse 30, and read. Then I was beside him as a master crafter.